Okay, first question. How can we make sure that the result was favored by all audiences and not just one audience or one part of the audience, which would then have skewed the result?
Yeah, so in general, if you look at your data that you get from the test, so you will be able to first of all look at the testing tool. So in Google Optimize or in any testing tool, you can usually see how the overall data behaves, but you're also able to filter the data by different segments that you created. And even with Google Optimize, you can just go to Google Analytics and actually see the analytics data from your different segments from the test. So this usually tells you how does campaign traffic convert, how does social traffic convert, and so on. And I would also always look in these segments, because you might have an improvement for any channel, but then maybe your organic traffic is much, much worse with the test results, which would mean that you might want to roll out the results or the winning variation only for some segments, but not for everyone.
Cool. Then next question. What is actually a good timing on how long a test should run? Is there a certain formula or calculation that helps to figure out when the data is valid?
Yeah, so it depends, like always, but there are different tools that you can use online to calculate the time that your test will probably run. However, to use these calculators, you kind of need to guess a result. So you need to guess an uplift, like 10% uplift or 5% uplift, and then depending on the uplift you get, you will get the duration of your test. So you can just Google for test duration or A/B test duration calculator, and then you find it. However, it's all just guesswork, so you never really know in the beginning.
Yeah. Then next question. Any tips for successfully implementing videos? Do you need to implement them in a certain position? Is a YouTube video the best way to go?
I would say YouTube is not the best way to go, because with YouTube videos, it's not possible anymore to make people not be able to leave your website through the video. So you will always have the YouTube branding in there, which people can click to get to the page of your video on YouTube. So I would rather use something like Vimeo or any self-hosted player where people awaken kind of control how it looks like. And about the placement and so on, so it always depends again. So if you have a video as a hero shot, which can work, so you're basically your main image or your main visual of your page is a video, then I would of course put it in the beginning, but you shouldn't just make it autoplay. So always try to make people understand, why should I click this? So have some sort of introduction, some sort of headline where people understand, okay, what do I get from this video and how long does it take to watch it? And then make it possible for people to click, because if people come to your page, they might just be on mobile data or something. So if your video starts, this is for many people on mobile data a reason to just instantly leave your site and to kind of hate you for it, because you're stealing their data. So I would never use autoplay, but if you use autoplay only on desktops, which can be possible, then at least don't play it with sound. So leave the sound off all the time, but people can of course manually start the sound. However, where you place them depends on the context. So you can have videos that explain some detail of your product, then of course put it in the content somewhere, or if it's just an overall explanation on what you're offering on the page, then you can put it at the top of your page. But test it.
And then a follow-up question, videos from me, especially the award-winning design agencies in the last couple of years often have this auto-playing background video as like the background of the header.
Yeah.
Any conversion insights into that? Personally, I hate it, but it was the way to go to win design awards like 3 years ago.
Yeah, in general, I would say design awards, or you have the CSS3 awards and something, it's usually the awards for the most unusable sites. So it's sites that where people showed off their coding skills, where they say, okay, I don't know, I'm able to have a parallax scrolling background with when you scroll, things appear and you don't know why. And so this is not really helpful for any visitor. But yeah, I wouldn't use autoplay background videos, because usually it's, I mean, we talked about visual hierarchy in the webinar, and you kind of mess it up. So if there's something moving in the background, you have no control on where people look, and this is a bad thing. However, it can work in special cases. So if you, I don't know, if you're selling something like holiday holidays to, or I don't know, vacations where people surf, like surf vacations, and you have a background where you see people surfing, this can actually help. So, but I would rather not use it. But again, you can test how it works. But many times, a moving background is not the way to go.
But it conveys emotion so well.
Of course.
Another question: do you have examples of web pages that use header white space as well? Or some general best practices for header white space?
Yeah. Yeah, so one page that does it pretty nicely is hhotels.com or hahotels.com, which is h-hotels.com. And there you can see it. You might, they have it very, very subtle, so the benefits are not really visible. So you could even test making them more visible. But yeah, for them, because their header is very colorful anyway, and you don't want to distract the view so much. So yeah, for them, I guess this works really well.
And the last question is from Greg, who has a question why you were concerned with GDPR when it comes to conversion testing.
In general, with any tool that you use that tracks people, which testing tools do, you always have to have some information in your privacy policy. And maybe if you have a bigger company, you might have a legal department, and it's a huge pain in the stomach to implement new tools. And if you already use analytics, which most sites do, it's usually very easy to add Google Optimize to it because it's a part of Google Analytics.
Yeah, and I guess Hotjar, for example, would then be one of these examples where when you add it, you need to update your policies.
Right.
Make sure you only drop the cookie when you're allowed to drop it, etc., etc.
Yeah. Although, yeah, most tools, or not most tools, but Hotjar, for example, even offers a privacy policy paragraph that you can just use. So, yeah, they make it easy for people.
That were all the questions.
Okay, then, thanks.